Welcome. You are about to take a journey to a place of the divine love within with Deborah Beauvais on the Love by Intuition show. For the next hour, allow her to prepare you in becoming a magnet for a profound love-infused relationship by identifying and focusing on solutions through love. Awaken the light within and let your essence shine. And now, here's Deborah Beauvais on Love by Intuition. All part of the Dream Vision 7 Radio Network.
Welcome, everyone. Bonjour, mes amis. And yes, here I am, Deborah Beauvais, founder and owner of the Dream Vision 7 Radio Network. If you're tuning in for the first time, we are a Boston-based syndicated full operating internet radio station. You can listen to us wherever you are in the world. You can ask Alexa to play Dream Vision 7 Radio. You can listen in the cars, wherever you are. And we are also connected to over 55 podcast directories, and it keeps growing, so it's hard to keep track of all of them. But that's who we are. And before I introduce you to our wonderful guests, I had an experience with my sister. We went to a restaurant that offered gluten-free and dairy-free options. And the reason I'm bringing that up is many of you may know that I'm celiac and also dairy-free. We went to this restaurant, and I was so in gratitude, I wanted to share about them. It's Blackie's. It's a neighborhood eatery in the heart of Smithfield, Rhode Island. They pride themselves on having fresh, seasonal menu items suited for everyone, including the allergen-sensitive. I'd like to do a shout-out to owners Janine Inatucci and executive chef Angie Amanese. True foodies at heart, dedicated by using local ingredients, making and executing Blackie's offerings from scratch daily, giving back to the community and fostering a positive environment. I had, for the first time out in the world in the last 20 years, grilled pizza with cheese on it that I could eat, and I didn't get sick. So that's why I'm so excited about them, and I can't wait to go back. To get in touch with them, you can call 401-231-4777. Or go to Eat at Blackie's, and Blackie's is with blackies.com, eatatblackies.com. So again, check them out. If you're in the area, you will not be disappointed. And on top of it, it is a rocking place. We sat at the bar. It was so fun, lively, and it wasn't screaming loud to boot. So it was nice. Okay. Switching to our guest, I have invited Tim Maceyko. I actually heard him through our Catherine Daniel show, Retreat to Peace, which is on Wednesdays, 10 a.m. and 10 p.m. Eastern Time. And I just felt so connected that he needs to be on Love by Intuition to share his journey and to inspire others, and that's what the whole station is about. So Tim, at 16 years of age, was left paralyzed from the neck down due to an automobile accident. And then his five-year-old son passed unexpectedly. And we're going to talk about adversity, what has happened, and how a bit about his journey and what his wisdom is for everyone that is either trying to get by with losing a loved one, especially a child, or you want to know what to say to people that have lost a child. So without further ado, Tim, welcome to the show.
Well, thank you for having me. It's a pleasure to be here.
Thank you. Thank you. So let's start with, share a little bit about your journey going back to when you were 16. And I'm curious, do you have full mobility? It sounds like you do.
I do. So first of all, I got to tell you, I love the accent. That Boston accent is so cool. I'm from Ohio, so, you know, we don't think we have an accent. But I love hearing the Boston and the Jersey, all those accents. It's pretty cool stuff.
Thank you.
my adversity started at a pretty young age. I was 16 years old, and I was in basketball season, like every typical young guy would be during the month of February. And we were taking groceries to a shut-in, a friend of the family. So it was a family afternoon on Sunday. We were taking groceries there, and I stayed in the car while my parents took the groceries inside. And a driver just came across the road and hit our car head-on and completely demolished the car and left me with a broken neck. I was very fortunate to survive, but I was left completely paralyzed, quadriplegic from the neck down. And the first 24 hours or so, they just weren't sure if I was going to make it. And fortunately, I did. But then I was took a long time for the paralyzation to start working its way back. And so the left side recovered fairly quickly. But within a few weeks, it started getting full strength again. But the right side was really slow for recovery. And I guess what happens, I broke the C4 and C5 vertebrae. And the doctor explained that when that occurs, typically you'll lose strength on one side of the body and the feeling on the other side. So my left side I couldn't feel pain. And so I could like pinch myself, cut myself, and I really wouldn't feel like a normal person would. And even now, all these years later, it still is a little more numb than my right side. But even now, I do have difficulty on the right side of the body. I don't have the dexterity in my limbs, so I drag my foot, I stumble, and people go, hey, you have a nice trip, and all those traditional fun things, but they don't realize that, a long time ago, I couldn't walk. So I'm very fortunate to even be able to walk, let alone if I have a limp or I walk awkward or I look funny walking. I'm just blessed to be able to do that.
Absolutely. Now, did the doctors figure that you weren't going to? Were they thinking that there was no way you were going to get out of a wheelchair?
Yeah, they weren't sure what was going to happen. In fact, they were talking outside the room. I never forgot this conversation. My mom went outside the doorway of the room thinking that I couldn't hear them, that private conversation. And I remember saying to the doctor, is he ever going to walk again? And the doctors, said, well, we have no idea. We just can't tell you that because the injury was so severe that they didn't know. But as a 16-year-old athletic young man, my expectation was, hey, I'm going to be back on the basketball court next week, which was, obviously not even in the cards, but in my mind, which I think helped because I didn't know. I always joke to say I was too young and dumb to know any better. But I think that was a benefit because I was able to just mentally be prepared to, okay, I'm going to walk again. I'm going to play ball again. I'm going to do all the things that I plan to do, and this is not going to hold me back. Because it was a long, painful process overcoming something like that, as you can imagine. And it wasn't easy, and it didn't happen overnight, and it was very, very difficult. In fact, the other day, that was about a year ago now, we were at a stoplight, and a young kid rear-ended our vehicle. He didn't hit it super hard, but my neck snapped, and because of my injury, I had to go to the doctor because I had, whiplash. So they did the MRIs and all this. Well, my original doctor obviously retired all these years later, but a new doctor was there, and he walked in, and he said, oh, like surprise, and that kind of, worried me, right? I'm like, oh, that's not good. And he saw my look on my face because he said, no, it's okay. He said, I was surprised because when I looked at your MRI, I have never seen anyone with that kind of injury not be in a wheelchair. He said, you're first.
Wow.
And so that was like, okay, wow, God works in mysterious ways, if you will. I just, for him to say that kind of hit home for me all the years later to think, maybe I really shouldn't have been walking, but I did. And so I appreciate every day.
Yes. Now, do you believe that your faith helped you heal and determination as well?
Yeah. I don't talk about this a lot, at least I didn't used to, and I'm a little more comfortable with now, but there was a point where they got a hospital bed in our home. So mom and dad were able to get that in the home, and I was able to move back home after 17 days in the hospital. My mom was caring for me, just like the nurse, doing all those things. Mothers are so wonderful, right?
And yes.
But but I wasn't recovering. It was slow, and I was depressed, and I couldn't go to the ball games. I was stuck in my home. I had to be homeschooled what I could do when I had the energy. It was just a very miserable existence, and I felt so distraught that I just didn't want to live anymore. And one night, I decided that I didn't want to go on. And so I wheeled myself into the kitchen when everyone was asleep, and I took out the knife, anticipating that I was just going to end it all, if you will. And as I sat there, I heard this voice, and it sounded like a male voice that came across the room, and it said, "Don't, stop," something along those lines. And then I had this vision of me laying there, in a pool of blood, and my little sister coming out and screaming, and then my mom running in the room, and all this flashed in my mind, and then it just stopped. And then I sat back and started crying, these tears. And I felt like in that moment, God in my faith had come through and said, "No, there's so much more." And he was showing me, what could possibly happen if I went through with this. And so I got back in bed that night, and I cried myself to sleep again. And the most amazing thing happened. The following week, I made the most progress that I had made in all those months prior. It was just like something switched in that moment, and I got my hope back, and I got my belief back. And then from then on, it was, it wasn't overnight, but it was much more progressive, and I could see the work I was putting in was paying off. And so I think the faith really helped, and I hold on to that.
Yes. And you mentioned hope, and I think, with all the challenges and the tragedies and the pain that many of us go through just because we're on earth, and that's part of our journey to, I believe, to grow our souls, and how we do that is through experiences and feeling the emotions that come with those experiences, how devastating they can be. And so when you have that flicker of hope, it really is something. It's tangible because you feel just a tiny little lighter that, okay, I can do this. Or it gives you strength for another day because this hope. And you mention it a number of times throughout the book. So do you feel that other than faith and knowing there's a higher, a higher guidance, a higher creator, something higher than us here just doing our thing, how important is hope to you?
Yeah, well, it's interesting because I think there's a lot of different religions in the world, right? A lot of different ways to look at your faith, and whether you can be an atheist and still feel like there's a connection to something that's bigger than you. So I always say it's not just the Christian faith, but you have all the isms of the world, the Buddhism and Hinduism, all these different belief systems, Sikhism, Taoism, all this stuff. But I've studied it all, and it all comes back to some of the same principles about this higher power and this connection. And I think when you can feel that. I think all of us can feel that. Again, even if you're an atheist, I don't believe in God, you still feel something that's pulling you to be more than what you are, to be better than what you are. And that's kind of where that hope comes in to play. I think we need that in our lives, or else, why are we living, right? I heard one time someone said, hope stands for hold on, pain ends. And I really like
hold
that.
On hold what? On,
hold on, pain ends. Hope.
Oh.
So the H-O-P-E, hold on, pain ends. And I like that idea that's when we need the hope the most, is when we're in our lowest points in life and we feel just so desperate and we feel like we can't go on. And we always get this in our minds that this is only happening to me. Nobody else, you feel like you're alone, like nobody else has ever gone through that. But the fact is, most of the things that we experience, somebody else has gone through them, as horrible as they can be. Like in my case, somebody else broke their neck before me. Somebody else had to be in a wheelchair. And I'm blessed because I got out of the wheelchair. Other people have not gotten out of the wheelchairs. And having that sense of hope really allows you to look at the possibilities of what can still come from the tragedy you're in.
Right, and that there are possibilities, that there still are. But yet when you're experiencing something like what you and your family have, it's very hard to to be in a space of hope, but yet when it does come, it's a flicker of energy that can give you another day in your lowest time. So with that said, share a bit about Seth. He is 5 years old, and share a little bit of what happened there and the devastation of living without him.
Yeah, actually, it's ironic that when I booked this show with you, I wasn't looking at my calendar close enough. It didn't dawn on me that this is actually Seth's birthday. And so we...
Oh, you know what? Oh, my gosh, because when I was reading towards the end of the book, I saw November, and I was like, oh, my gosh, he is coming on in the month of Seth without knowing that it's his birthday as well.
Yeah, it didn't dawn on me when I booked it, and then I told my wife today, I said, we'll go out to dinner after the show, get a late dinner with the family, just kind of remember and do that, because it's been a long day off, of course. But yeah, so Seth, it was just one of those weird things where, you know, we had a great family life, you know, so I broke the neck, I recovered, and fast forward years later, I'm married, and we have multiple children in the home, and one morning, I get up and I take Seth to the babysitter because my wife always gets up earlier than I do and leaves the house before I do in the mornings. And so I got him ready that morning and I took him to the babysitter and I hugged him and I loved him and said, you know, I'll love you, see you later. And I go to work. And it never, ever crossed my mind that that would be the last morning that I would see him alive. Because that evening, I'm standing in the emergency room and the doctor looks at me and says, I'm sorry, we did everything we could. And that was it. And it was just like in that instant, that was more profound. I would take that broken neck and be in the wheelchair over and over, you know, a million times before I would want to experience the pain of that very moment when you find out your child is no longer here. Because the physical pain is one thing, but that emotional, the mental, and there's still physical symptoms, is so much more profound. I never would have dreamt the things that your body goes through and your mind goes through in that moment. Because right when she said that, everything I thought I knew from God and religion to the way the world works in general, it all just switched off. It was like it went from light to darkness instantly. And it was just such a profound moment in time. And for those who may be wondering, again, one of the things that we don't talk about a lot because it's hard to talk about the death of your child, but we do share, because I worked with the Consumer Product Safety Commission, I worked with my congressman at the time, but he died in an unusual bunk bed accident where he was out on the top bunk and some things happened there, a little bit of details, but you could probably use your imagination of some of the horrific things that could potentially happen. So I always encourage people to think about the bunk beds you have, especially the newer versions aren't so bad. The older versions, the ones that get handed down from generation to generation, some of those are very unsafe, and they create potential hazards for a young child. They have the labels on them, you know, to say, serious injury could occur if you allow the under 7 to play on the top bunk. But when you think serious injury, you think, oh, they might break an arm, a leg, hit their head, you know, something along those lines.
Right.
They didn't say fatality. But they do now. I've seen a lot of the newer ones actually say fatality can occur. And I like to believe that we had a play in that because we worked with the Consumer Product Safety Commission saying, hey, you know, this didn't say fatality. You know, I mean, I would have never, ever allowed him to ever be up on that top bunk if there was any chance of that. I wouldn't have that thing in my home. And so, you know, through our foundation, we kind of push that message about safety and make your parents are aware of that. But back to the fact that he passed, and it's been the most difficult journey I've ever experienced.
Yes, and time, you know, as far as when people say time, it gets better, they don't realize because they haven't experienced it at that level. And that's one of the things later in the book, and we can talk about that later. People don't know what they should say or not say. But you live with it every day. And it's hard not to live because it's your life. It's your memories. It's everything. It's the child you created. So I can't imagine I wouldn't want to be in that space, but it isn't something that you can just get better and move on with life. It just doesn't happen that way.
Correct.
And there it is. And you know, unfortunately, and maybe it's good that they don't understand. They haven't experienced it. But anyhow, I'm so glad to hear that you've worked with different Congress people or whoever it is that you worked with, and now with your foundation, to a lot of it with everything is awareness. So people don't know unless they've experienced it or you're within that family unit and you know what it can do. I would like to think that there's been such, in the last 10 years, there's been such change with bunk beds, but it doesn't sound like it. It sounds like from what you're saying, they're just labeling it can cause death.
Yeah, they you know, everything in our world is political at times to get things done and push through and get regulations. And I read that there was a lot of blowback when they were trying years ago. Like there was hundreds of kids that died prior to my child in the same type of manner, which is unfortunate. And, you know, we never heard of that craziness. But the people, the manufacturers that make the beds and the furniture and stuff had pushed back, and so it became recommendations, not necessarily requirements, right? So there wasn't these regulations that really should have been in place. And I think they're better now. I haven't followed it recently, to be honest with you, but I know they were working on it, and I've seen some improvements, and the styles are a lot different than they used to be. So I hold out hope that, you know, that is better in that regards.
Yes. So let's talk about the understanding of why and what you go through reliving, what you could have done, what you should have done, if you just did this, if you just did that, did he have to go at five, you know, is it God's fault, all of that, please share.
Yeah, so you're going to really struggle. First of all, you want to assign blame to everything. You're going to feel guilt. Whether you did anything wrong or not, you're still mentally, you're going to feel guilty. You're going to feel like someone needs to be blamed. So if you're not the party that's guilty, then it's so-and-so caused this to my child. Or if nothing else, God caused this to my child. Right? It's the way your body and your mental state has to adapt. And so that's one of the things I always talk about, is the fact that, understand, that's part of the healing process. It's part of this stages of grief, as they say. But when Seth died, we couldn't go back in the home because it occurred in the home. And my wife said, you know, I can't be there. And she had a whole different situation than I did. I was at work, and she was home with them, and she had to call 911 and go through this very traumatic, horrifying moment in time. And so after the passing, we stayed at my mom's house in town. And I remember that I tried to lay with her the first night. I couldn't sleep. There's no way I could sleep. And so her sister laid with her in the bedroom, and I sat out on the couch all night, and I would just sit up, and I would argue with God. And I would call him names. I would question him. I'd say, you know, what kind of God are you to allow these things to happen? You know, you don't exist. And all these things that it would be natural you're angry, right? And so I took it out on him, and after three nights, I didn't sleep for three nights. Well, the third night, I finally fell asleep. But for the two nights, I didn't sleep. On the third night, I fell asleep. And then about 4 o'clock in the morning, I fell asleep about 2 in the morning, about 4 or so, I woke up and I had these visions. And I talked about this in the book. Kind of reminds me of back when I had that vision as a teenager. But this time, it was a vision of the time I spent with Seth and the positive moments and the snuggle time And I wrote that down, and I put it out on Facebook at the time, because that was the only thing. I had my phone at like 4 o'clock in the morning, it's dark, and my sister set up a Facebook page for Seth, and I went on there, and I just shared my thoughts and feelings in that moment. And that went like viral. I had like 200,000, 300,000, whatever it was, that it got shared. I just shared it everywhere. And it was like a moment at the time I didn't think was so important, because I just didn't think of that as a sign or a vision. I just thought it was a thought that popped in my head. And my wife got up the next morning, and she asked me if I got my sign from Seth. And I said, no, you know, the world doesn't work that way, because I don't think it works that way. That was my thought at the time. And I never thought in that moment that that was a sign. And I really do now. I look back and I think about when I was a teenager and that vision I had, and then this moment that God or whatever you want to call it, I call him God, mm-hmm. gave me what I needed in that moment, and once again, gave you a little bit of hope.
Yes. Well, we need to take our first break, so hang in there, Tim. There's so much more we want to share and talk about. Everyone stay with us. We'll be back in a moment more with Tim Maceyko.
Experience a different yet profound healing with Reconnective Healing. Includes yet expands beyond any and all known forms of energy healing. The Reconnective Healing Spectrum is comprised of the full healing and evolutionary continuum of energy, light, and information. It allows for healings that are not just physical, not just mental, not just emotional, yet go beyond that to bring healing that includes the evolution of your very being and essence. Deborah Beauvais, trained and certified by world-renowned Dr. Eric Pearl, offers appointment hours at Seekonk Family Chiropractic in Seekonk, Massachusetts. For questions or to set up both distance or local sessions, call Deborah at 508-431-1959. Again, 508-431-1959. Or go to lovebyintuition.com. That's lovebyintuition.com.
Calling all authors. Have you been considering an audiobook? Well, look no further. Come take advantage of DreamVision 7 Radio Network's unique in-house audiobook production, which includes benefits and bonuses from our radio station. Let our knowledgeable staff guide you to create the audiobook you've always dreamed of without breaking the bank. Check out our full one-stop service from A to Z, including the ACX process. Schedule a free consultation by calling 508-226-1723. That's 508-226-1723. Or go to DreamVision7Radio.com.
After narrowly surviving the attack on Sandy Hook Elementary, first grade teacher Caitlin Royd DeBellis was left searching for answers that would never come. Eventually, she chose to focus on questions that could be answered. How do I make sure this tragedy doesn't define us? How do we get our control back? Those two questions led her to found the 501c3 nonprofit organization, Classes for Classes. When gifts poured into their classroom, she decided they would help someone else by paying it forward and being kind. This developed into a social network which allows K-8 classrooms to connect so that every student in the United States can learn these crucial lessons. Classes for Classes' mission is to build students' social-emotional intelligence by connecting them to care. All C4C projects are crowdfunded. Any teacher in the U.S. can visit classesforclasses.org. That's classes, the number 4, classes.org. Sign up today.
Delight your kids with an enchanting journey by reading the Paper Doll Kids children's book by Deborah Beauvais and Janine Sullivan. There's even a catchy tune, Kids for Love Song, produced by Bob Sherwood and sung by kids just like yours. The story weaves around 7 paper dolls flying around the world doing good deeds as they bring important attention to our endangered animal friends. There's even a magical ring with a universal message. Kids become interested in service projects, action through compassion, and planting seeds that nurture positive change. The Paper Doll Kids and Kids for Love Song are a production of the Kids for Love Project. Get the book now on Amazon Kindle and the song on CD Baby or iTunes.
This is Dream Vision 7 Radio Network, uniting mankind with universal love. Our shows are created from the heart, bringing each listener to a place of divine enlightenment. Breathe, relax, and enjoy. Let life flow.
And we are back. This is a live show, by the way. Everyone out there that listens knows Bob is in the house, and you can call in, talk with Tim or I if you have a question or a thought. Our toll-free number is 833-220-1200, 833-220-1200. Don't hesitate because the time goes by quickly, so call in now. If you'd like to get in touch with Tim, you can go, he has two sites, timmaceyko.com. Tim, as we all know, T-I-M, Maceyko is M as in mother, A, C as in candy, E, Y, K-O.com. He also has another site called faithbeyond.org. That's a nonprofit. Again, it's just as it sounds, faithbeyond.org. So I want to thank you so much for sharing all the information you are, because it's going to help others that listen. It may be that they are better with helping others that have experienced such a tragedy, or they may it may help them. Maybe they are in a place where it's fresher and they need help and healing. And that was one of my questions, Tim. Writing this book, I bet that you had a lot of healing within just by writing.
Yeah, actually. So when the Cardinal calls, the book you're referring to, I wrote that more as a therapeutic thing. It started off that it was just my way of writing and getting my feelings out and my thoughts out. And so that was the intention. I didn't really intend it to go out and start selling, you know, to the public per se. But as it developed, it became clear that people were wanting to hear that whole story. They were wanting to hear this thing. And so I started talking a little bit more about some of the really cool things I experienced along with the negatives, and kind of went through how we coped with it, how we went day to day. And I'm planning on updating that and actually making that into an audiobook as well here in the very near future. But yes, it was definitely therapeutic, and they tell you that's one of the things that is very helpful, is if you journal or write out your thoughts and feelings. And even if you're not writing a book, just keeping that, it's a great outlet.
Yes. One of the things you say early on in the book is keeping your eyes wide open. And it was when you were experiencing the dolphins. My question is, have you kept your eyes wide open?
Oh, absolutely. I see the world entirely differently. Like right now, people get worked up about politics or different issues that are in the news that the media covers, all these different things. And I find myself, I may have an opinion, but number one, I may not express it very often. Like, if you look at my social media pages, you won't see anything political on there. Because number one, I know that it doesn't, at the end of the day, help me in my journey to find peace and find calmness and find this passion and this purpose if I get caught up in these negative views and I got to take a side over this and hate these people over there. And that's such a negative energy. And so now I look at things much differently.
Exactly. So with what you're sharing, because it's not helping anyone. And I think people need to stop and think, even what they're saying in a repetitive way about something in the political world, that may not be true, but someone else said it or they read it somewhere and they think it's truth. And if it's negative, then it's feeding negative energy. If it's positive, it's feeding love consciousness. And which one would you want? Which one feels better? Tell us about the Cardinal and the baseball. And that, I'm getting goosebumps just saying that phrase. That was phenomenal.
Yeah, so I'll back up a little bit. So I talked about falling asleep that third night and getting those visions of Seth and I. But prior to going to sleep that night, my wife had come out and she'd said, you know, here's Seth's little toy, one of his little toys she had possession of. She's like, I'm going to leave this here with you, and I think your son's going to come and see you. And she's very, like, hopeful like that, and she has this different view. I was very much a scientific guy. I was raised in the Lutheran church, very traditional. My father was actually Catholic before that, so I had a certain mindset when it came to those things. And so I'm like, yeah, he's not coming to see me. His life doesn't work that way. So then I fell asleep. I told you a story about waking up with the visions. And then she got up that morning. She said, you know, did you get your sign? I said, no, I didn't get a sign. And I said, but I am going to go out the house, and I want to change the clothes. I want to pet the dogs. I want to be in my own home. And she said, well, I can't go out there yet. I said, that's fine. You know, that's fine. I get it. But I'm going to go out. And so I went out, and I got her a change of clothes. I took my shower, and I got my change of clothes, and I pet the dog and all these wonderful things. Well, her sister's there. And her sister, Linda, looks at me and says, when I come out of the shower and got dressed and came out, she said, have you got your sign yet? And at this point, I'm like literally laughing a little bit. I mean, I wasn't laughing much at that moment in my life, but I mean, like mentally, I'm like, what is wrong with these sisters? Like, what kind of weirdos are they? Like, I couldn't wrap my mind around that. And I said, no, I haven't got a sign. And she said, well, I think you're getting one right now. And she pointed out the back window. Now, our our window of our kitchen outlooks over the backyard, which has a whole bunch of trees in the back. And there was this bright red cardinal sitting there, and he was staring right into the window at us. And I live in Ohio, and the cardinal's a state bird, so it's not unusual to see a cardinal. But this cardinal was the brightest I had ever seen in my entire life. He just glowed. I mean, he was so cool looking. And so I said, I got to get a picture of this. So I go out the back door, and I kind of approach him carefully, and I take a picture. It's not very good, so I get a little closer trying to get a better view. And he's chirping at me like crazy. And then he stops, and he jumps a couple branches, which causes me to kind of follow him. And then he stops where he's on this new branch, and he starts chirping at me again. And we play this little song and dance back and forth where he goes down the tree line and chirps and stops and jumps another branch or two and then chirps and stops. And I'm sorry, emulating him. We're having this little conversation, which I don't know what we're saying, but we're having a conversation. And then all of a sudden, he stops it at one point, and he just goes crazy, chirping and singing his song and all those things, those noises they make. And I'm like, what is wrong with this bird? I've never heard one get that emphatic. And then in my mind, I just said, look down. And I look down, and they're between the toes of my shoes. And it's really cool because I always tell people, not like in the general vicinity, not like to my left, to my right. Literally, I'm standing over top of this baseball. It is right dead center of my body on the ground below me. And it was the ball that my son Seth had lost the weekend before he died. And he had freaked out over losing that ball because he didn't want Dad to be upset. I mean, he had a ton of baseballs, but in his mind, his five-year-old mind, I lost one of Dad's baseballs. He's going to be so upset with me, and he was frustrated by that. And here I am a few days after his death, and this cardinal has taken me along this tree line and stopped me over top of this baseball. And I picked it up, and I said, is this my sign? And the bird chirped again at me, flew back to the original branch where he started from for just a second, chirped again, and then flew away. And it was like right then, that was when I really and truly got that sense of hope back. Like the vision gave me a little bit of glimmer of like, okay, maybe, you know, I didn't remember the good things. But this encounter was so unexplainable in my world, so unexplainable that I was like, okay, I don't understand how things work after all. So maybe there is hope.
Right. I mean, life is so mysterious. The afterlife is so mysterious. I mean, there's near-death experiences, and there are doctors like Dr. Eben Alexander in Boston. He was, you know, like many people, would never believe anything in that sort, but then he had the experience. So, I mean, there's so much we don't know, and there's so much that we know and we don't really know. Do you know what I'm saying? So, yeah. But when messages come like that, it warms the heart and it soothes the soul. Even if it's temporary, it soothes. And from reading your book, which is When the Cardinal Calls, there's so many messages that you receive. I just felt that Seth is with you anyway, and our loved ones are closer than we realize. As I've said before, we're just not vibrating at a higher enough level to see that right now, and maybe someday we will. I don't know. But the bottom line is they're with us. And many times we might be in such grief we don't even notice, but then there are other times they're so profound, you just know that it's real, it's not a dream, it's real. So with that said, I'm feeling you in the sense of experience this. Do you feel comfortable sharing a few more? And now you're a believer that there is communication. It can't be anything else but communication from your loved one.
I agree, and I would have never believed it. You could not have convinced me. Like, if I was listening to this show right now and I heard this guy talking about this, he could talk all day long to me and I would not believe it, because that was my mindset.
Sure.
And that encounter with the bird started to change that mindset, and it gave me a new look. It gave me some hope, because now I had something like to say, maybe I did have a moment. And even if it wasn't Seth, it was God or something giving me a message, right? I mean, that's how it felt in that moment. Although it felt like it was Seth, but it could have been just a message for me to say, hold on, things are going to get better. But then things started happening around the house that I could not explain. And I quit trying to explain. There were so many things. Some were really out there, and some I was able to mentally say, okay, well, logically, this could have happened. This may be why that happened. But then there were other things that I had no way of beginning to explain. I was like talking about the fan, because one day we were sitting in the family room. It was just me and my wife, and I was kind of nodding off, and she said, Tim, kind of woke me up, and I'm like grouchy, like, what do you want? Why are you waking me up? She said, look at the fan. And I said, okay, it's turning really slowly, you know? And she's like, well, the switch isn't on. And I'm like, well, okay, a current can still get through there, a draft. I mean, something's probably moving the fan. It's not a big deal. And then it kind of stopped, and I was like, yeah, there you go. See, told you, you know, no big deal. And then it started up again in the opposite direction. And it started moving at a fairly rapid pace, considering that there was no breeze in the room, right? The window wasn't open. It was just no real good reason. And the light switch definitely wasn't on. But here's the thing that really confused me was, okay, even if the current was getting through there, the fan would turn one way. It wouldn't stop and turn the opposite way because you split that switch for it to reverse direction. So I have no idea. I can't explain that. If someone out there can explain it, please email me. That one's blowing my mind to this day that I have no explanation. But there's things like that that started occurring that really did convince me that I can't explain these things. And so I went in and did more research, and I've heard so many stories from other people with similar experiences. And I was talking, and I forget his name off the top of my head, but he's a professor at West Virginia, I believe it was, and he was studying children who were having these past life experiences. Mm-hmm. We conversed a little bit, and he invited me down. I never got to drive down to his laboratory or his college campus there and see his layout. But it was really fascinating to me because I was never one who would think of like reincarnation as being a possibility. But he was explaining, and he wrote these books about it, about how these young kids, 2, 3, 4 years old even, would have this knowledge of a previous life that they claimed to have lived.
Right.
And then as they got older, they forgot it. But they knew all these details that they should not know. And so some of them he disproved, and some of them he could never disprove, so essentially proving that it probably, you know, there's something there. And so is it the fact that we are still connected to other people, or did you lead a past life? I mean, those are the kind of things that I've been studying that just blow my mind, and there's no good explanation for them.
Right. Okay, we need to take our second break, and everyone stay with us. We'll be back more with Tim Maceyko, author of When the Cardinal Calls.
Take a journey to a place of the divine love within with Deborah Beauvais on the Love by Intuition show, Monday through Friday at 6 p.m. and 6 a.m. Eastern. Our message is love in the purest form. The light within us all is a guide to recall our beginning, to learn to love self and humankind, and to feel the higher power of our own divinity. To attract love, one needs to be love. Come join us and step into this glorious vibration called love.
Delight your kids with an enchanting journey by reading the Paper Doll Kids children's book by Deborah Beauvais and Janine Sullivan. There's even a catchy tune, Kids for Love Song, produced by Bob Sherwood and sung by kids just like yours. The story weaves around 7 paper dolls flying around the world doing good deeds as they bring important attention to our endangered animal friends. There's even a magical ring with a universal message. Kids become interested in service projects, action through compassion, and planting seeds that nurture positive change. The Paper Doll Kids and Kids for Love Song are a production of the Kids for Love Project. Get the book now on Amazon Kindle and the song on CD Baby or iTunes.
Are miracles real? Can you move from mayhem to miracles? 30 prominent authors say yes as they share their high fives and down lows of challenges, abuse, addiction, and love. Experience hope, the magic elixir of miracles, through the personal stories of New York Times bestselling authors James Redfield, Dr. Bernie Siegel, Sister Jenna, Reverend Temple Hayes, and many more. If you like bestsellers, chaos to clarity, and crappy to happy, you'll love crying and laughing through mayhem to miracles. Sacred Stories of Transformational Hope, available now on Amazon and in bookstores worldwide.
It's a child's job to play, to learn, and to have fun. It's an adult's job to keep them safe. Did you know that 1 in 4 girls and 1 in 6 boys will be sexually abused before the age of 18? Every day, families enter the Children's Advocacy Center because a child's courage to tell someone what happened to them. Keeping our children safe starts with a conversation. This is Michelle Aranger, Executive Director of the Children's Advocacy Center. Learn more on how to keep your child safe. Visit cacofbc.org. This message made possible by the Fall River Rotary Club.
This is Dream Vision 7 Radio Network, uniting mankind with universal love. Our shows are created from the heart, bringing each listener to a place of divine enlightenment. Breathe, relax, and enjoy. Let life flow.
And we are back, and I was thinking about our conversation, Tim, during the break, and a lot of what happens is just fear. People that are questioning things. I mean, questions, I'm the question queen. I'm not talking about it in that respect. But they're stuck in their fear, so it's hard for them to believe almost anything goodness, any miraculous things. They're stuck in that fear, which is unfortunate. And what are your thoughts on that? And with everything that you've experienced, you've now realized that love is the most important. Love is all there is.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I think that, well, you know, when you look back at the psychology of when we go through something traumatic, you know, whether that be grief and loss of, you know, a loved one that unexpectedly passed, or cancer, or a serious illness, disease, whatever, what happens is we carry this emotional baggage with us. And that's where that insecurity and the fear and the self-doubt and the pain and the hurt, all that stuff kind of bogs us down, and we don't know how to move forward, and we get stuck. And I think a lot of people have this emotional baggage that kind of holds them back from advancing, whether that's in a new way, in a more positive way, if you will, or what it may be. But I think that we have to, like, learn how to kind of turn that corner, so to speak, and overcome these self-doubts and these insecurities. And then I think we can open our mind at that point to new ideas and new possibilities. And I just think sometimes it's easier to bury your head in the sand and say, okay, this is the way I was always taught. This is what I believe, and I'm not changing it. I don't care how much proof you have or how much other ideas you have. I'm just, this is who I am. This is the way I'm going to be. And I used to be that way, but again, you're not going to advance in your spiritual growth, your emotional growth, your mental health growth. It's hard to grow if you don't want to, right?
That's right. You're stuck, period. Yes. Tim has written another book, Seth, Snuggle, Time, Game. And we, Dream Vision 7, actually chose it as Book of the Month for November. It's a kid's book. All you have to do is join our free newsletter, and you're in the book drawings, which we have 3 every month. But please tell us about Seth, Snuggle, Time, Game.
Yeah, so I mentioned earlier that I had that vision on the third morning of
yes.
Seth and I, and this is where that book came from. So this book was completely inspired. I always tell people when we talk about Seth's Uncle Time Game, my name is on the book as the author because someone had to put it together, but it's Seth's story. It's not even Tim Maceyko's story. It's Seth Maceyko's story that I just had the privilege and honor of sharing, and it's a beautiful story because it's a children's book, it's a picture book, and it's about the nightly ritual we'd have, and where he would come in and Seth would say, "Do you know what time it is?" And I would say, "Is it time to clean your room?" And he'd be like, "No, no, it's not time to clean my room." And I'd say, "Is it time for you to brush your teeth? You know, time for you to get a job?" And he'd be like, "No, I'm only 5, Dad." You know, these fun, bantering interactions. And then I would say, "Is it snuggle time?" And he'd be like, "Yes, it's snuggle time." And then he'd get up my lap, and we'd either read a book or maybe watch a TV show, but we'd do something where we're having that moment of bonding and time together. And it was just really special, and it happened pretty much every night in our home. The snuggle time book came about off of that story, and so it was changed into this little monkey and his family, and it goes from his nightly ritual that ends with the snuggle time game. And so it kind of relives that story. And I never imagined the response we get out of that book. We've had people send us pictures of them reading the book. I get people here, you know, it's been about, I don't know, it came out like 5, 6, 7 years ago now. And people still email me and say, hey, my child still pulls it off the shelf and I'll see them read it. Or now my grandbaby is reading it. You know, it's really wonderful to hear. And as we looked at the book, I decided we need to do a little bit more with it. So in the back of the book, we added two little games. One, SJ the monkey tells the reader how to play the Snuggle Time game so they can create their own moments of snuggle time and those, you know, very precious moments we all should have in our life. And the second thing was for even younger ones, where we put that red cardinal that I saw that day, we put him in on every page of the book. And so it says, go back and find all the cardinals. Count all the cardinals you can find. And so it's a little game like Where's Waldo, right? Go back and find the cardinal and have fun with that. So I was told that some of the younger ones especially love going back and finding and counting the cardinals. And so it's meant to be a piece of, you know, literature, but it's meant to be something that can help you bond with your child, not just another book you throw on the shelf and never read again. That's not the intention of it. And so some of the proceeds from that book, actually, when someone buys on Amazon or wherever they might buy it, we then donate some of that to the 501c3, whatever profit margin we have on that book at the time. So that book's really special to me, and it's not something that I really look to make money on. It's something, though, that we try to then raise some money for the nonprofit when we can.
Yes, very good. I love adding the cardinals and making that a game. That's perfect. Before we run out of time, because we only have a little bit of time left, you are writing another book.
Yes, I am working on it. I don't really have the title nailed down exactly, but right now I'm kind of leaning towards Rising from the Ashes, Finding Fulfillment and Success, Finding Life Fulfillment and Success After Adversity Strikes. So what the premise of the book is, taking these last 10 years now and not just telling, like I told my story today, I told my story in my other books, but now how do we take the adversity we face? How do we overcome that emotional baggage I spoke of a few moments ago? How do we make some kind of positive growth in our lives? So how do we overcome this? And not only that, but a lot of us go through life, because we all face some level of adversity, but a lot of us go through life and we feel empty. We never feel fulfilled. And so in this book, it's about finding that life fulfillment. So it's a guide that's meant to help you feel like you're living your purpose, I guess is the best way to put it, right? Because if you're not living your purpose, you're always going to feel empty. You're always going to feel off. Nothing's ever going to feel right. You can have all the money in the world and still not feel like you're fulfilled, because you're probably not living your true purpose. And so that's what we're going to talk about.
Yeah, beautiful. I think that's wonderful. So we look forward to that. We have a couple minutes. Can you give a couple of thoughts on how to talk about loss for people that are listening?
Yeah, so, you know, if you're listening, you're looking to talk to someone who's lost a child or just lost a loved one, there's some things that I found that a lot of people will tell you are the worst things they can hear, which these are things that are like cliches in our society. I mean, we'll say these things all the time, you know, you're so strong. And people actually will tell me, I hate that. Oh, I'm not strong. Even people think you're strong, but you're completely broken. You don't have a choice but to come across a certain way in certain situations. But that really bothers them. And, you know, God needed another angel. You know, that's another one that child loss people bring up. Like, yes. Why do you need my baby, right? I mean, so these are the kinds of things that we say that we just don't understand. We don't understand, like, we mean well when we say them, and they know we mean well, but they don't help. And what I found is this. I want to make this point. Society doesn't handle loss and grief well at all. It's just in general terms, right? We think we need to assign a time frame, and then that person should be over and back to work and leading life and moving on. And
that's
the way it is. And when it comes to child loss especially, you never move on. There was a study done that said the death of a child is the worst stressor a person can go through, and some parents will never be able to move on from that loss. So they have to learn to live with the loss. So you can move forward in life, but you're going to still live with it to some degree. And I think our society doesn't understand that, and so you expect that parent to just get over it. But you can't get over it. It's not going to work that way. And unless you've been there, you won't understand it. So what can you do for that parent? It's none of these sayings that we use. Those are all useless in my book. What you need is to, just, number one, be there.
Right.
And that's really it.
I mean, right.
It is really just the fact that you're standing there in that room with them in that moment. The fact you put your hand on maybe their shoulder, or you just pat them or whatever, or maybe don't touch them at all if they don't want to be touched. But, I mean, you know, if you're just there, they know you're
right
there, and that's enough in that moment. They don't need you to come up with a solution. There's nothing you can say that's going to make them feel better. So just
right
being able to help me, for example, you bring food, that's great. You know, these types of things,
yeah,
you know. And the other thing that society messes up is they still want to talk about their child years later. And a lot of times people are like, oh, we can't mention Seth. Don't talk about Seth anymore. But, man, I love hearing stories. I remember when Seth used to do this at the ball field, right? And so
yeah,
we crave that because we don't want our children to be forgotten, and we have no new memory. So you as a parent are posting your pictures and all the wonderful things you're doing, your vacations, and we post an old picture because that's all we have, and then all of a sudden oh, I'm so sorry. But we don't need
mm-hmm,
to work
right
hard. We just wanted you to recognize that they're still there in our minds.
Exactly. And that's a huge point, Tim, is people want to talk about them. And there's nothing unhealthy about it. It is healthy to talk about them and because they're part of your life. And it just is. Another point, and then we've got to fly, is that people will say, call me if you need me. Well, to change that and switch that around, call them. Don't wait for them who are in grief and in devastation to call you and say, I need help. You call them. And even if it's a conversation, a short conversation, that fills that person up with love for that moment. I'm so glad that you brought up these points. I've so enjoyed you, Tim. Everything that you've shared will help and is helping others. And I am, my heart is touching. I'm honored to be doing this on Seth's birthday. So happy birthday, Seth. And thank you again, Tim.
Thank you for having me. I really appreciate it.
Yes, we'll be in touch. All right, and everyone listening, share the show. Listen to it again because it's something you can take away to have a better life or to be in a better place for another person. Until we come together again, au revoir.
Are you seeking a clearer path to love? Then tune in to the Love by Intuition show next week, all designed to your highest good. To contact Deborah Beauvais, owner of Empowered Connections, call her at 508-226-1723. That's 508-226-1723. Or link on to lovebyintuition.com. Remember, we are all one, and we are all part of the miracle of love.
This is Dream Vision 7 Radio Network, uniting mankind with universal love. Our shows are created from the heart, bringing each listener to a place of divine enlightenment. Breathe, relax, and enjoy. Let life flow.